Hey guys, welcome back to the GD podcast. Yep, that's right. We named it. And it's not goddamn, it is definitely Gaming Derailed. Love to see what you guys think about that in the comments. Joining me are Rhapsody to my right and Orbital Potato hiding behind the screen as always below me. How you guys doing?
How's the weather today actually, guys? How's the weather today with you? It's pretty grimy where I am.
Brutally hot and sunny. It is supposed to hit 100 degrees tomorrow.
No, give me that in real world temperatures, not your
Fahrenheit. Do I have to run the converter here?
This is two against one, man. Like, you should not be using... I'm sorry, right? But a country that
37.7 degrees Celsius.
Fuck my life.
Let me cry a tear for you. Fuck my life, that's... What?
Bloody, are you kidding me?
Get to 44 and then come back and talk to me.
Yeah, but also have 90% humidity, so.
Well,
okay, maybe not literally 90%, but it's very, very high.
This is the thing. Temperature is completely relevant because for me, that would literally be the hottest day that this country has probably ever experienced.
You would have a heat stroke. You would go outside and you'd start sweating. Then you'd turn cherry tomato red and stop sweating, which is actually worse. And then you would keel over.
Yeah, it would be.
We'd have a roasted potato in our hands.
Actually, a baked potato, I'll have you know. But
okay, sorry.
It would depend on whether he was in the sun or in the shade when he passed out.
Yeah. No, you know, I just thought I'd live up to the name of derailing the topic of conversation within the first.
Oh, we were thoroughly derailed.
10 seconds, you know, just walking joke, but nobody picked up on it. Hey ho.
So here is what I think must have gone through Brink's mind when he came up with GD. We've got to name this GD podcast.
You're closer than you might like to think.
I like it. It's flexible. And, you know, we can introduce it as something different every week. So one week it can be, oh, this is Gaming Derailed. And next week it's something else that starts with GD, right? That could be the running joke, right? We can always
figure out all the same sentence, didn't you?
Yeah, I tried to figure out something else that started with GD, but nothing came to me. Yeah. So,
well, gosh darn it.
Well, yeah, I thought of gosh darn it, but like maybe, I don't know, the Godly Divine podcast? maybe. Come on, I'm fishing in the dark here. Like, I'm fishing.
We can just take a week to talk about news from the papacy.
Yeah. That actually might be hilarious to do for an April Fool's.
That would be great. That would be absolutely hilarious. Man. That'd be great.
So anyway, we've finally figured out a name for the podcast, but we are still taking questions from the people who are listening. And we actually forgot to address this last week, but there was a really, really good one that we do want to talk about. And if you guys have any questions about life, love, the pursuit of happiness, or anything to do with gaming or us personally, definitely hit us up in the comments. But we had this question come in. If you could choose a game to obliterate, and that means... every trace of its existence is gone. Your memories of playing it are gone. The game no longer exists. What game would it be? Somebody kick us off because I have no idea on this one.
Orbital, do you have an immediate reaction or am I going to have to use my hot take?
You use your hot take. You go for your hot take.
Minecraft.
Whatever the hell that means.
What?
Really? Really?
I actually got some enjoyment out of Minecraft.
It's a good game.
I got some enjoyment out of Minecraft in the alpha stages as well. But I feel what it has become and the community that it has created is just abysmal. It's really, really not good. Now, I wasn't prepared to defend this idea, which is why it was a hot take. It came to my mind immediately. I just want to obliterate it mostly because it introduced a bunch of things to the relevant gaming sphere that I'm not really okay with. Like bringing survival crafting stuff back to the super, super forefront to the point that it's being integrated into AAA games at this point.
Yes.
Is it's something that if you obliterated that game, you would remove a lot of the impetus for being brought into or even wedged into, not necessarily needing to be wedged into Fallout 4 games.
Why does everything come full circle?
Everything
to Fallout
comes back
4
to Fallout
sucks.
4 because it is a good example of everything wrong with the games industry at the moment, or a lot of the things at least. But it would. I mean, if I'm gonna have to use my hot take, it's gonna have to be Minecraft, specifically for the influence it's had on the gaming community and for gaming development as a whole.
I don't know that I would fully agree with that one, because it has also brought some good things, such as it's kind of popularized animation tools. So, like, there's a lot more people nowadays who know how to do animation and make cartoons and things because they've worked with those editors and tools that have moved on to other projects. Granted, a lot of it is still just, like, sludge collecting in YouTube, but there has been some talent come from it. And I don't know. A lot of people have gotten a lot of enjoyment out of that game, and it's also kind of created an outlet for people who want to do insane things, such as build a working computer that you can play Minecraft on inside of Minecraft, which is kind of cool. But
oh yeah, there's always like a cool news story around the corner about Minecraft and what someone's managed to do with Minecraft.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it just, it's never sat right with me, the fact that something that was this huge indie darling is now this unnaturally large phenomena that has become so mainstream as to change the mainstream itself in such a significant and, in my opinion, strictly negative way.
Gotcha.
I mean, I disagree with that. I think that's a little bit silly. But you know what? It's okay.
Hey,
you can have your opinion.
Why don't you go first with your quick opinion, and then we can throw you under the bus?
You know, so I've actually had a little bit of a think about this while you were rambling on about how much of a negative force for the world and how it was a completely terrible thing. There was this game.
It caused cancer. Minecraft caused cancer. It actually went back in time and it created cancer, and that's why humans die of cancer.
All right. Just hear me out on this one. So I requested a game from a game developer, and I didn't expect it to be good, okay? And it wasn't good, okay? It was fucking terrible. Probably the worst game that I have ever played on my channel.
You need a name.
And it's called Blueprint Tycoon, okay? It is called Blueprint Tycoon. And
I've never actually heard of this game.
Believe you me, you don't want to. Like, don't actively seek it out, because then you will not do me any justice. Just leave this game alone. It is the least fun piece of shit game probably that I've ever played, actually. And I've played a lot of unfun piece of shit games in my time. It sucks so much ass. It's complex. It's dumb. The resources are stupid. I don't understand how it's even a blueprint tycoon, because you actually build shit and you don't really place blueprints. You know what? I can't explain it without completely sounding like an overqualified douchebag or an underqualified douchebag.
It's one of those games that you played and it was such a leech on your life that you wish that you could just take back everything, rewind time, and just do something else.
I mean, I made a great video about it. So, you know, check that out on my channel. Just search Orbital Potato Blueprint Tycoon, just in case you're interested. You know, give it a like while you're there and subscribe to my channel if you're interested. But yeah, pretty much. I wish I could rewind time and just completely undo this. Only played 54 minutes of it.
If you're not watching the video, both Rhapsody and I are just rolling our eyes and shaking our heads because potato.
Honest, are you fucking kidding me? Rhapsody gives Minecraft. It's like, oh yeah, that gets a pass. All right. Orbital Potato brings up this stupid game that is actually fucking terrible, and suddenly brings, like, oh my god,
Potato, what are you doing?
I'll remind you, I had good justification for mine, and I didn't talk about the quality of the game. As far as I'm concerned, Minecraft is a good game, and I specifically strayed away from talking about that, and I talked about the impact it's had on community and the community of game development large. However, yours has just been, it's a bad game, it wasn't fun, it's needlessly complex, but also not good. Subscribe to my channel!
It's a scam. It's a complete scam. It is a game that is completely underdeveloped. I don't really imagine that it's ever going to be more fleshed out than it currently is. It's leeching off the name Tycoon, which people go apeshit for. And I honestly think that it is a true scam. And I really would rather it just didn't exist. Does that make you happy? Is that justification any more up to scratch for you, Mr.
A little bit. Is it in early access at the moment?
Oh, of course it's an early access. You'd be ridiculous to think.
Well, there's your first mistake.
Honestly,
I've played exactly two early access games that were actually worth my time. 99% of the time, if it has the early access tag, you can just like kick it to the curb and wait, and it will just die under a rock somewhere without you having to pay attention to it.
That's actually a really interesting discussion. How many early access games have you played where the early access felt like something that you wanted to play, something that you're actually interested in dealing with? Because I can only think of one off the top of my head currently, and that's Darkest Dungeon.
All right. I want to go back to this Blueprint Tycoon.
No, we need to gaming derail.
Fuck off. This is important. You know how I said it was an early access? When I played it, there was no changes. Almost no changes. Completely remaking the tutorial, displaying better information, polishing up scenarios. That are the only changes that are listed between early access and full release. This game is a scam. It is a fucking scam. It's made by the same fucking people that made, you know, their knockoff Game Development Tycoon thing. That Game Development Tycoon thing. You know,
I think the potato GDX just got thing. Burned and it made him even more salty.
I don't get burnt. I'm preaching here, brother. This is the Godly Divine podcast. Get with it.
There's two types of early access that are kind of semi worth something, and a third type that just brings out the trash. So the worst one, and the one that there's tons of, is just the obviously unfinished game that will never be finished, that tries to get money from people riding on the hopes that the game will someday turn into something, and it eventually just gets scrapped. Or it's just a piece of trash, just straight up a piece of trash. But there's two that are successful. And I've played a couple of them. One type is every survival game ever, where basically they go in under the early access tag with just enough content to keep people busy for more time than the refund system will let them refund the money. And then they roll out changes and additions to the game to where eventually you end up with something good. But that's like 8 months of grinding on a progressively somewhat better game. And then the other type is like, what was the chicken game? Crap. Forgot the name. There was a RTS.
Chicken Death Robots? Chicken Death Robots or something?
No.
The space one. The one in space.
Yes.
Shit. Can't remember.
I can't remember the name of it. I had it and then I went to talk about it and it's gone. But anyway, it went on early access basically just as a server and feature test. And it was on early access for a month. And it was basically a complete game. They went through and like 80% of the user submitted suggestions got put into the game and then they released it in full. And it genuinely was a test. It's like, instead of releasing the game and doing a massive patch a month after the game is released, they went into early access, let people try it that wanted to try it, did their huge patch that fixed everything, and then for real released the game. So it was like an even more polished game than it could have been if they had just straight up released it. And like that's a good use of early access. But Anyway, a game that I would obliterate from existence. Have either of you guys heard of or played Diddy Kong Racing?
Yep.
No.
It was a Nintendo 64 game from way back. And looking back on it, it was probably a good game. Probably a good game. But it was a terrible experience for me. Because I was like 7, maybe 8 years old when I played it. And up to that point, I played entirely Nintendo games, and most of them were either on the NES or the 64. And I had beaten every single one of them. And, well, except for Mario 3. I never could get past the Bowser stage. But anyway, in Diddy Kong Racing, I got to the very end of it where this huge pig that is like 40 feet tall is chasing you through the canyons. And I could never beat him. And I played that thing for like 2 or 3 hours straight trying to beat this pig and could not do it. And then for like a week after that, I had these horrible nightmares about a pig chasing me down in my dreams and trying to kill me. And it was horrible. And I don't ever want to go back there. And I wish that game didn't exist. Really bad logic, but that's the only one that I can come up with.
That's one of the few games that has Tip-Top in it. You know, the famous turtle, Tip-Top.
Yeah.
Who?
Exactly.
You don't need to know.
Exactly.
Point you're making. Okay. Oh, well.
So yeah, that's a worthless contribution to the conversation. But honestly, even if you've had a bad experience with the game, I don't know. I don't know that I would actually obliterate, because you can usually learn something or get something useful out of the vast majority of game experiences. At the very least, you learn what you don't like and then don't waste any time on that genre in the future.
I mean, yes. Yeah, the more games you play, the more you realize that 90% of early access games need more work, and you probably shouldn't play them until they're full games.
Potato That's just needs to not play any more early access titles.
You see, some early access titles are really good, and others are just garbage, like Blueprint Tycoon. That's right.
Hot garbage.
Blueprint Tycoon. You know that one? Garbage. Yeah, it's actually French for rubbish. But, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Man.
So...
Oh my God. My God.
Among all of the trash that is going to be filtering down on us in the next couple of weeks or so, E3 is coming. And let me sum up my entire feeling about E3 with this statement. Watch Dogs 2 was just announced.
I mean, I think there's a bigger discussion to be had here. And I think it's about how E3 hasn't even started, but companies are already starting to try and get the drop on E3, which is weird.
But if what you have is not worth announcing, yeah, you've like got a Call of Duty game that is the most disliked video release on YouTube of all times. You have Watch Dogs 2, a sequel to a game that most people hated. I mean, why are you looking at me funny, Rhapsody?
Just a small, quick, I think, correction. I'm pretty certain it's the most disliked game trailer of all time. I'm pretty sure most disliked game video trailer is still held by Friday.
I'm sorry. Disliked game trailer on YouTube.
Come on, man.
Anyway. Like
you're supposed to know these things.
It seems E3 is just a collection of junk.
Well, I mean, like, for all of the people trying to get, for all of the companies rather, trying to get the drop on one another for the start of E3, it's because it's not, E3 isn't for us. E3 isn't for the fans. E3 isn't for people who are interested in the industry. E3 is for industry insiders and the business, right? It's for the press. It is not really the show for the people anymore. That kind of thing is now PAX. So
yeah,
this
but they
is
still
just
hype it up as such.
Their precedent.
I don't know. I think companies honestly will take any opportunity that they can get to show off their products. So
this is true.
I think E3 is just another on a long list of things when they could potentially announce some new products. I don't know though.
Yeah.
I'm not really that interested,
but
to be honest.
It's not the point I'm trying to make is that it's not the consumer fair that it used to be. right? It's literally just dominated by people who are waiting all year to do their announcements at E3 because it's the biggest thing, specifically for the press.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I suppose.
Talking specifically about Watch Dogs, though, is anyone at all fucking interested? You know what? How about this? Either of you, tell me the name of the main character in Watch Dogs 1. The iconic main character.
No, that was something that people criticized. The Watch Dogs characters were just hollow. Like, everybody said that they were completely hollow. But
I think
the game
it was
concept,
Aiden Pierce.
Was it? I have no idea.
Fuck if I know,
that
right?
Sounds familiar. Another example of
this. Exactly. Another example of this same kind of, like, super really big and shiny, but hollow on the inside. Tell me the name of one character or, quote, one line from Avatar, the most high-grossing film of all time. Tell me anything about it.
Well, I actually watched it.
Unobtainium.
So... there was a thing in it called Unobtainium. Good work.
But that was
actually a real thing.
That was memed everywhere.
The blue guy flew the big red dragon. Yeah.
Okay,
that was a really cool film. I liked it. I thought it was a good film. I quite enjoyed watching it. It was a good romp.
So hollow and fluffy.
It makes no sense. Like, once you go past the surface, like, the lack of logic in Avatar is just disturbing. The amount of ways that the thing goes horribly wrong. I mean, they all have big mechanized suits, so why do they use the mental link to travel? I don't understand. I don't even want to get into it. It's just
because
one huge
reasons.
Mess.
The only reason I wanted to bring that up is because it's another example of this incredibly big AAA release, right? One in film, one in game.
Yes.
Is going to be spawning a franchise because apparently they're going to be making more Avatar films. By the way, spoiler alert, just in
three
case
more.
Three because more. Everything has to be a trilogy. Everything has to be a trilogy that has to be at least 7 hours long. Everything has to be a trilogy. Ever since Lord of the Rings was so successful, everything has to be a trilogy with 2 hours plus per film.
To be fair, Lord of the Rings was good. And then they tried to do it with The Hobbit, and no one was buying it.
I know. I have not watched any of the Hobbit films because I'm just completely uninclined to. Because everything I've heard about it is, oh, they departed so much from the book and they put so much fluff in and everything is a spectacle show instead of the interesting storylines and the songs and the lore that were in The Hobbit, the book. And that was what was so good about the Lord of the Rings films was that they stayed so true to the books. But, well, that and all of the accidents that they had on stage that helped the film look more real. Hilarious articles, by the way, if you Google that. My favorite is the one Aragorn breaking his toe when he kicks the helmet. It's epic.
I'm really hyped for Watch Dogs 2, actually. Like, on a conceptual level, Watch Dogs 1 was, like, dope. Like, you could just go around hacking people. That is, you know, that is a really interesting sort of mechanic. So, I'm actually really interested to see what they do because if they can improve on the story and stuff and make people actually give a damn, then I'm actually quite excited for it. I don't want to judge it before it comes out.
So
we'll have to wait and see. I'm quite excited to see the cinematic trailer the gameplay trailer that's going to come out, and it's going to look really, really cool, and it's going to be really hyping.
And then there's going to be a graphical downgrade.
Exactly. Well, not just graphical, but actually gameplay that doesn't exist. Like the level of interaction that whatever the main character's name is had with the world in the gameplay trailer that was shown at E3 for the first announcement of Watch Dogs was not in the final game.
Yeah.
Nowhere near. So I'm really excited to see the trailer and look at the vertical slice that they're going to present and go, well, that would be a really good game if it existed, and then never look at anything for it again.
I'm still waiting for the class action lawsuit where a bunch of people get together and sue a game publisher for false promises.
Well, I mean, it's literally a bait and switch in a bunch of situations.
I would laugh my ass off. Is
the game as it currently exists, and you present it in a way that actually does not represent the final product. That is the definition of bait and switch, to try and present something in such a way as to get people to buy it when that is not actually the eventual thing that they're going to get.
So a game that just completely removed the entire reason that I even gave a damn about the franchise. FIFA 17 just announced that they're getting rid of their existing engine and starting to use Battlefield's Frostbite engine. So
FIFA? The fuck is FIFA?
FIFA. Jesus Christ.
I'm sorry. FIFA. I've never even played one of the games. The only interaction
No. Shut up. We're going to call it FIFA from here on in, just because that's fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
All right. Tell me about FIFA.
Abandoning their previous engine so that they can go with the Battlefront, rather. Three engine.
I should have asked, because I'm a stupid American and we don't know what to do with soccer anyway. Football. I know it's football.
It's not soccer. Like, it's just fucking not soccer. Like, football was created before America was, right? So it's like, you know what I mean? Like, it literally was created in medieval times.
Soccer is what you started doing with your spare time after we kicked your asses back across the ocean. Come on now.
I mean, it's just a fact of life that football is older than America. So that's just
okay.
You know. Anyway, yeah, FIFA. Yeah, FIFA. FIFA.
Okay. Anyway, the only reason I cared about this at all was because watching YouTube compilations of the freaking monstrosities that occur in this game is highly entertaining. And now they're going to have a game engine that actually works, which is kind of disappointing on a certain level.
RIP, the only reason to be interested in the FIFA franchise.
Hey, you're saying it wrong.
Right? FIFA, my bad. FIFA. Sorry, I forgot.
FIFA, come on, get with it. No, I actually really like this approach coming out from FIFA, because there's a really good game engine in Battlefield 4, which I think used the Frostbite 3 engine. Battlefield 3 was on the Frostbite 2, which I personally like absolutely loved. It just feels so like meaty. And my problem with playing FIFA games before, and you know, I haven't played very many FIFA games, but I have played a little bit of FIFA in the FIFA in the past. I haven't played many FIFA games in the past, but they just didn't feel like they were quite there. And in comparison to PES, which is Pro Evolution Soccer, stupid name for a game franchise, I know, but. Apparently that's got much more of a, you know, a meaty feel to it, and it feels like you're more in control of the ball. So take that as you will from somebody who doesn't play FIFA, who doesn't really watch football or soccer, whatever the hell you want to call it. But yeah, only a good step in the right direction. Why not? Why the hell not? Sign me up.
How dare you talk about this seriously when all we wanted to talk about is the glitches?
I mean, there's other games that all people know about it as the glitches. It should be an entire genre unto itself.
Yeah, it's called early access, man.
If you were in the room with me, I would give you a high five for that one. That was
pretty good, right? That was pretty good.
I was thinking more of Tony Hawk games, but whatever.
That's a good point. I mean,
does that now as well.
I feel that the latest Tony Hawk game is like an honorary early access title, right? Because there was like a 2 gigabyte download on the first day or something. So that's basically early access in my eyes. Honorary early access title.
Now, if you're talking about the most recent one, okay, there's actually a story that goes with that, because apparently what had happened was they did not get the game done on the last day before their rights for publication were going to expire. So they shipped all of their discs with only the tutorial on it. And the game, the actual game, was in the first update. Like, when you installed the game on your console or on PC, the day one patch was like 5 gigabytes because it was the game. And they did that because they were pushing their publication date out to literally the last day before they lost the rights to the Tony Hawk franchise.
So, good thing they lost the rights too, because if you're going to push out shovelware like that just to make a quick buck, I'm not interested you holding the rights to a franchise that I've historically liked. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 1 through Underground 2 were amazing games.
It's still glitchy as all hell, but it's not fun glitchy. It's just this game doesn't work anymore. Glitchy.
Oh, well. Well, let's just take a moment once again to appreciate my hilarious joke. Like, take a moment.
Let it die.
I'm going to take away the high five he gave you. Like, I'm just going to, like, there it goes. No more high five for you.
I'm not even going to fight it. It's gone. I'm done.
Speaking of that engine and Battlefront 3, a fan remake for Battlefront 3 is being allowed to be published on Steam for no price whatsoever. Otherwise, of course, they're going to have a bunch of legal issues on their hands. But that's a really interesting precedent for a AAA game to be remade by an indie studio so quickly and published for free.
You're conflating Battlefront and Battlefield.
This says Battlefront 3.
It is Battlefront. It's a remake of Battlefront 2, I believe.
Yes, but Battlefield uses the Frostbite. Never mind. Anyway.
Yeah,
I'm with
Rapsy on this one. I think it kind of worked. It was a good transition. It was a good segue.
Okay.
Speaking of segues, I would love to own a segue. How cool would a segue be? Come on. That would be so wouldn't it?
One of the only maps in Battlefront 3 was Hoth, which is made of ice, which is relatively low temperature, which should be described as cool. However, there's a fan remake on Steam.
Oh man, this guy. You're on fire, like the moon of Tatooine after Imperial
fighting the derailment
assault.
For all he's worth. I'm actually kind of excited about this one because, as I've stated before, Battlefront 2 was freaking amazing. If they're taking the experience of Battlefront 2 and creating a new one, then I am all for this project.
Let's be clear, right? This is never going to get published. First things first.
It's already been approved to go on Steam.
It's been approved to go on Steam, but Valve has got nothing to lose by sticking it up on Steam. It's never going to get published. Disney's going to send a cease and desist, and that's going to be it. It's going to be killed, dead in the water. Either that, or they'd be like, oh, hey, why don't you guys develop this us? We'll license it to you or something, and
I forgot that Star Wars was Disney now, and Disney kills
You forgot
everything.
That Star Wars was Disney. Disney is going to kill it.
If it was still under LucasArts, it would probably fly.
No, it probably wouldn't. It's going to die. Well, whatever the case, it's going to die. And it's going to die, and we shouldn't be getting our hopes up. In addition to that, even in the super, super, super unlikely event that it actually gets through, it's a tiny, tiny indie development studio. And I am not for a second saying that indie devs are not hardworking, fantastically amazing at developing games. But this is like the studio's first game, as far as I'm aware. And I would be questionable. I don't think it's going to make it. I don't think it's going to make it. I hope it does. I hope that it survives. I'd love to play it, but I think
here's
it's going to die
along the
way.
The two hardest things to do for a game are art assets and building the engine that everything operates in. And they were basically handed a functioning engine because development got fairly far on what would have been Battlefront 3 until EA killed it. So they've got the engine, and then they're basically just porting all of the assets from other Star Wars Enterprises. So it's actually not that hard to put together piecemeal.
But... yeah, but that makes it way more likely that they get C&D'd if they're using actual assets and art from other Star Wars games that have been published.
What they have done is they renamed you're right. I can't remember what they've renamed it as. It's something like Galaxy on Fire or some stupid name like that. But it, yeah. It's basically Star Wars.
Hold on, let me, I've actually got it here.
It's so Star Wars-y that it's almost, I guarantee, you know what, let's place our bet on it right now.
Galaxy in Turmoil.
All right, there you go. See, because Galaxy on Fire was probably already taken, so they didn't want two lawsuits coming their way. Okay, I'm willing to bet 10 smackaroos, 10 fantastic British pounds that this game is never going to be published. 10 British pounds. That's like $3,000 in America.
Do you lose the bet if it gets published and stays up for a week before it gets taken down with a cease and desist? Because it's technically been published and people have downloaded it.
I'd pay out if it was published that. But early access.
Okay, I'll take your bet.
Early access doesn't count. We're talking full, but we're talking full. Rhapsody, which side do you want to get in on? Because there's a chance of profit on this, buddy. Chance of profit.
Orbital, I'm a student.
Yeah?
I don't have money to bet with.
Would you like to bet ramen noodles?
I had to move. I had to go a few suburbs over so that I could find a little Asian grocer that I could get the specific brand of ramen noodles from, because someone told me about this really cool thing you can do where while you're cooking them, you can just crack an egg in there and it'll cook while the rest of the noodles are.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's just relatively relevant to my recent life. Yes, I've been surviving off ramen.
You can also buy cheap pork and add a little bit of soy sauce.
I'm really interested in doing. Put some bok choy in there as well. Man, let's have a party.
Actually, okay, are we derailing onto the cooking topics?
Oh, you know what? If you got some fucking hot ramen noodle cooking tips,
dude,
I'm totally down.
No, I just did my second round. I learned how to cook fried rice, and it's freaking amazing. Fried rice and steak. Oh, so good. So good.
That's a combo I hadn't considered.
Yeah. It's like, if you go to Japanese food places over here, you can get fried rice and steak, and I usually don't get veggies with it, but they have this white sauce that goes with it. I have no idea what it's called, but it is one of the best things I've ever tasted, and it's amazing. But it's like $15 a plate, so I was kind of trying to figure out how to get it for cheaper, and I can cook it at home for like $4 a plate. So
nice
adventures were had.
Well,
that's the way to do it.
All right. Well, I guess I'm going to be up 10 pounds by the end of this. So
not by the end of the podcast. This is going to be far out in the future.
In like 5 years, whenever Disney eventually sends its cease and desist. There we go. That was a great story about food. I enjoyed that. That was fantastic.
I like food, as is probably apparent.
Yeah. Food's pretty good.
I carry a lot of it with me wherever I go.
I keep the memories of food past and present.
Oh my goodness. So some people aren't that poor from their student debt and young people antics and that kind of thing, because they get on Twitch and they get huge donations from people. And there was this story floating around a little while back, and I say a little while back, like 4 days ago, about iNexus Ninja is his screen name. I saw his real name, but I don't remember what it was. Anyway, an 18-year-old who was donating to Twitch streamers with amounts ranging from $1 to $5,000, and he was denied chargeback when he tried to refund. And it's something that's been floating around for a long time in the Twitch community, where basically people troll Twitch streamers by donating money and then recalling it after a few days, hopefully after the streamer's already withdrawn the money. And it hits their account, and people think it's hilarious. But, there's actually more to this story than meets the eye. This is somewhat of a ramble, but I'm going to run this down and then get you guys' thoughts. I found this story. Let me bring it up right over here. Do-do-do. Yeah. Bam.
This is pretty dumb. Pretty dumb.
No, it actually is different than it seemed at first, because apparently a YouTuber live stream fails compiled a list of his donations to various streamers and then attached the chargeback story to it. But what actually happened was only $10,000 got charged back. And it was a donation to Chance Morris, known as Soda Poppin'. And he has actually legitimately donated thousands upon thousands of dollars to Twitch streamers, and it has all gone through. And the reason that he did the chargeback for Soda Poppin' was because he found out, quote, "A few people, not saying names, told me that he was already rich and did not need the money. He has a house in his name. He's very wealthy. So I decided to charge him back as he didn't really need it." Mm-hmm. So he donates this much money on a regular basis to people who stream on Twitch if he thinks that they actually need money. Which kind of turns the whole story on its head.
Yeah, it does. Well, I kind of prefer the easy to discuss story of, this guy got absolutely screwed trying to troll other people and got trolled himself, totally deserves it. That's a much easier story to discuss than this person who is actually being relatively philanthropic the gaming community, kind of got screwed by their own perception and then tried to fix that and got screwed again.
Yeah, but I mean,
Is there a moral here, guys? Is there a moral?
It does bring attention to the problem of the Twitch trolls who do this on a regular basis. Like, from what I understand, if you're streaming on Twitch and you get any donation $100 or more, you need to let it sit in your account 30 days. Because people will try to do chargebacks on you just to piss you off. And it is a serious problem. So kudos to PayPal for actually starting to flag this kind of thing. It's just kind of sucks that they picked this particular instance to do it in. So,
yeah.
Exactly. It's a flagrant abuse of the chargeback system, which is supposed to be used for, hey, this product or service wasn't actually provided to me. This was a fraudulent transaction, that kind of thing. Rather than, I'm going to donate to you. You're going to get all of the feelings of, yay, it's a donation, right? And then I'm going to rip that away. But on top of that, I'm going to publicize my own name throughout your entire stream and get a bunch of praise and thanks from all of your adoring fans and supporters.
Yeah, you put $500 in your PayPal and you donate the same $500 over and over and over again to all these different people.
Yeah.
That's something that's been plaguing the community for the longest time, which is why I thought this story was a long time coming. And then it turns out not to be the story that I thought it was going to be. God damn, it would have been so easy to laugh.
Dang you, YouTube rumor mill.
Exactly.
That's exactly it.
So this wasn't actually on our list, but did you see that Gawker is filing for bankruptcy?
Oh, thank God.
That story tickled me to no end. It made me so happy. So happy.
and another rule. Nobody gave a flying fuck that day. Gorgeous.
Another rumor mill bites the dust.
Yes.
Damn right. God. Quite rightfully so, I should think. I don't really know much about Gawker. Just I heard that they were dicks, so fuck them.
Pretty much. Couple of stories out of Hollywood, actually. For one thing, Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, another game that no one cares about, has recruited the actor from Game of Thrones, Kit Harington, to star as the villain, which is actually the second time. Who is the guy?
Kevin Spacey.
Yes, Kevin Spacey. Yes, in Advanced Warfare. What is it? What has caused this current trend where not only are they pulling in, I know pulling talent for voice actors is kind of common, because I mean, even Spyro was done by Elijah Wood at one point, wasn't he?
Was he famous at the time?
Who knows?
I'm trying to remember if it was before his first major role.
Well, I mean, it would have been, he would have been famous at the time because he was in, what was it, Deep Impact, which is like 1980 something. Right? He was a child actor.
So. Yeah. It's kind of funny to me that it's now beyond voice acting to where they actually model these people in the game in photorealistic detail and have them act in the game.
I think it's real good. I think it's really good. I think it's really, really, really good that this is happening because currently, at the moment, it's only like Call of Duty and stuff that is getting like the really big Hollywood talent to come on board. But I think that that is going to lead to a general acceptance of Hollywood becoming more in tune with the video games industry, so to speak. And so,
you know,
I think we'll see that talent filter through, which is really good for the whole community. And yeah, really great, actually.
You know what I think this actually is? This is the death cry of the Call of Duty franchise because they see themselves ceasing to be relevant and they're trying to use star power to bring in more people to the franchise to start playing it. Because they got Kevin Spacey at the height of the House of Cards buzz to do the last one. And now we're talking about one of the biggest TV shows of all times, Game of Thrones. They pulled one of the lead actors from Game of Thrones to do.
I think they're like, oh well, we're just gonna stop innovating, so I guess we better do something new. Let's get Game of Thrones guy. You know, the games haven't changed in a while, and they'll probably go back to not changing for a while. So why not bring somebody famous in so that it looks like we give a shit about this game?
Calling it right now.
Maybe.
With the success of Battlefield 1, either probably not next year because that game's already in development, but 2 years from now, Call of Duty is going to go back to World War 1 or World War 2.
Yeah, I'm on
because Battlefield did it, right. And it was super popular. So now Call of Duty is going to go.
Oh god, yeah.
Most liked game trailer of all time in comparison to Infinite Warfare, which is the most disliked. Actually, a few points that I wanted to make is I think it's getting more likely to happen based off of a few different things. First off, you have AAA publishers that have the ability to say to the largest Hollywood stars, why don't you just fucking act in a game? And since visual mapping and basically graphics technology is to the point that you can actually make a really good representation of a person and their acting skills and variety in a game, it's much more attractive to the actors as well. Another really good example of this recently is Until Dawn. I don't know if either of you saw much of it or played any of it.
Yeah, but it
did the same thing, right? All of the people in that were actual real-world actors. Rami Malek, Brett Dalton, Hayden Panettiere. They were real-world actors who just got completely mapped for the game. And for a lot of it, it looked really, really good. For a little bit, it was like seemingly unnatural, kind of in the uncanny valley where people would have like random face twitches. Like specifically, what was it? Skarsberg, the Nordic actor? What was his name? Like Peter Skarsgård.
What was the game that just came out recently? No, that is Quantum Break. Never mind.
Yes, Quantum Break had that.
Yeah,
with
same thing. Same thing.
Iceman from
where it like spliced from gameplay to live cutscenes, and you basically couldn't tell the difference.
That's crazy. I mean, that is awesome. That is great.
It's interesting if done well, but also. It's not always being done well. I personally felt that Until Dawn was like really good, but
yeah, it's gonna be interesting, especially with this new generation of video cards that's just come out, like the 1080. Yes. Just the sheer horsepower that the 1080 has. Because I don't remember if you guys remember. I don't know if you guys remember. Is it 2 years ago? I think. One of the demos that they were doing with the 980 Ti and the next gen NVIDIA rendering software was they had a realistic human head that was a kind of paired with the AI that would talk, and it could do. It was so close to being across the uncanny valley that's like your brain would accept it for 5 or 6 seconds. And then when it was transitioning between speaking phrases, you could kind of see those points. But like 2 years ago on last generation hardware, they had 99.9% crossed the Uncanny Valley. So mm-hmm. I'm wondering if once they get all of the drivers settled, these cards with this architecture is completely settled to the point where they can use it to the maximum extent possible, if they're actually going to hit the point in the next 12 months or so where they can generate a game where you can't tell the simulation from real life. Because that's going to be huge.
I think that bridge is being crossed faster than ever before. And that with that is going to come a large influx of people that are from traditional media moving into games media.
For sure.
Yeah.
I think you're right. And that's a good shout. I'm down to clown with that. Sign me up. I'll take it.
So the Warcraft movie came out. For those of us who actually went to see it, I did not, or I have not yet. I'm semi-interested. But I found it funny because before the movie came out, like all of the pre-release stuff, the critics were not super happy with it. But then you go to the actual box office results, and it is breaking records in China, huge number one releases in pretty much every other country. I think the only place where it was number two was in the Philippines, something like that. And most of the people who actually dabble in Warcraft lore like it, at least the ones that I've heard talk about it. So it's kind of like this huge rift between professional movie critics and people who actually want to watch Warcraft, where one side is saying it's not that great, and the other side is saying, you know, they did some really cool stuff with this.
So, I mean, there's a few things to talk about here and unpack. First off, how many other fucking big movies are out at the moment? Like, being number one when your competition is P.S. I Love You 2 isn't really... it's not really that good. The fact that you aren't number one everywhere makes that really touch and go and a little bit weird. But secondly, if you make a movie that can't just be enjoyed by everyone, like, if you have to know the Warcraft lore to be able to look at it and go, oh, I see what they're doing here, then you're not really making a good movie. You're making a companion to your game, right? Like, the MCU is a good example of this. A lot of people who know a lot about the specific, like, Earth 616, you know, your actual Marvel universe in the comics, they get to look at the movies and go, oh, here's the different things that they're doing. They're probably setting up this. There's all these really cool Easter eggs. And then everyone else just gets to look at it and go, that's really cool. Oh, this is a really nice story that's being explained to me and going throughout itself, right? And they tend to get relatively good critical reviews and they get wide praise from the public. But if you're not getting critical reviews, I have to feel like that's a fault on the part of the filmmaking and making it accessible to a wider or general audience.
I mean, I don't know if it's only people that are specifically interested in Warcraft. I imagine that people who aren't interested in Warcraft aren't going to see it. And that's probably because of these negative reviews. I don't think many people are going, oh, hey, that looks like kind of an interesting movie, if they see the reviews and are still going to watch it if they're not committed to this sort of universe. So I think that it's a little bit of weird selection bias that's going on, because the people who have played World of Warcraft will go and see it probably. And the people who haven't are being swayed away by the reviews, even though the people that don't know about the Warcraft lore might enjoy it. Although, honestly, I do not know. I've not played Warcraft, but I've heard that it's actually a really good film by some like individuals,
you know,
and they hadn't played Warcraft and they really liked it.
This is actually an interesting discussion because if you talk about genre bending, where you take a story and a lore from gaming and turn it into a movie, people have kind of been doing this with books for years. And as far as making it acceptable to the public, this is one of the things that anyone who reads books and watches movies almost always complains about the movie, because the movie is never as good as the book. Because anytime you adapt from one genre to another, you lose things. And so you could argue that it's actually a good thing if the Warcraft movie sticks closely to the lore and only caters to what the gamers already expect, because they're not going to destroy the fan base that they could potentially have by not being true to the original form. But at the same time, you know, I don't know.
You can argue that, but then release, first off, make it lower budget. Secondly, release the fucker online. There's no reason to give a big cinematic release worldwide.
This actually had $160 million budget for that. Holy hell. This thing got like Marvel Productions.
Marvel level backing, yeah.
Yeah.
That's multiple times more than the budget that went into the production of Deadpool. And it got critical acclaim and fan acclaim.
Yeah. So, muddy waters.
None of us have seen it.
Nope.
let me check if it's still in cinemas. I'll go.
Of course it is. No, it's only been out for a week. I've seen it.
But I don't think any of us are really interested in seeing it at this point.
I'm not interested in it, right? But I want to see it because it's going to make me the supreme authority on it. Let me see if...
Okay. Oh, yeah, you can be a baked potato supreme, and we're just going to keep on doing what we do because I don't... Do you play Warcraft, Rhapsody?
I have had a relatively long history with the Warcraft universe. I haven't played a lot of World of Warcraft. I got to like a level 40 character and I was like, this is dumb. I don't want to continue playing this. And then later on, I realized the only reason I thought it was dumb is because I was trying to play it as a solo RPG. Like I was just doing everything myself. There's no reason to play an MMO if you're going to be doing it like that. Just play a fucking normal solo single player actual RPG.
I've never even played it, so...
I also played through all of Warcraft 2 and all of Warcraft 3 and the expansions for those. I've played a lot of Hearthstone. I'm not super deep into the lore, but if I was going to be excited for this film, and I was excited for the release of this film, if I was going to be excited for it, it wouldn't be based on interest in the lore. It would be based on interest in seeing a game movie finally fucking succeed. Like, the best one before this was Hitman. Really?
Oh, God.
Best? Oh, God. Are you really going to use that? Those two words in the same sentence?
Theoretically, there is a best tasting shit in the world, right? That doesn't make you...
Theoretically.
All right. Let's wrap this up. I'm going to go and see it, okay? I'm going to go and see it tomorrow, okay? And we can talk about that. It on next week's podcast. And my word will be law, okay? My word... will be lost since you guys won't have nothing.
I'm actually on opposite you, Rhapsody, because the only reason I would go see it is for the lore. Because, I don't know, the lore of different games is what I find most intriguing. For instance, the Warhammer 40K universe. Playing through a few different games that take place in that universe, just learning about all the different characters, the factions, how everything goes together, the stories behind everyone, that is one of the more interesting parts to me. And Warcraft is kind of the same way. The only window that I've had into that universe is Hearthstone. I don't want to endure the monotony of an MMORPG in order to experience Warcraft. If I could get it in book form or movie form, I would genuinely enjoy it. So this might actually be something for me.
I honestly think that this is actually not going to be a terrible film because the guy that directed it, he directed probably one of my all-time favorite films called Moon. It was an insanely good film. Complete curveball. David Bowie's son, by the way, directed it.
Yeah.
Called Duncan Jones. And Moon. Let me just check his filmography. Yeah, he wrote and directed Moon, which I absolutely loved. If you haven't seen it, go and see it. He also directed Source Code, which I also super, super loved. And I'm going to see Warcraft. So we'll see what the hell happens. But I didn't realize that this guy had directed both Source Code and Moon, two films that I really, really, really liked. I think Source Code is one of the only films that I've actually watched twice. I hate watching films for a second time, but I think I've watched Source Code more than once. So that is a huge endorsement in my eyes. And okay. I've got an excuse to go and see it. I'll go and see it. I'd say it's pretty good.
So, something else that has happened this week, Halo Wars 2 was leaked. Now, I have screenshots, and there's a couple rumors floating around this, but at this point, they are only rumors, so bear that in mind. But there's a couple of pretty things floating around on the screen, and apparently there's potentially going to be an open beta June 13th through the 20th, which is next week, which if that is true, I'm pretty psyched for this game. Did either one of you guys play the original Halo Wars?
No, sir.
I had it. What? The campaign was pretty fun. The multiplayer was kind of meh because the unit cap was super low. But I'm hoping that if they have the same general gameplay style in this one with just a way higher unit cap, it ought to be pretty damn fun. So, there's that.
I don't even know what Halo is, all right? I don't even know what Halo is. I know Master Chef is apparently the main character. Yeah.
Yes, he ventures forth through the galaxy cooking the most delicious foods that he can find.
Exactly. Yeah, Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I thought. I know it's about aliens. I know that it came out on, like, the original Xbox. That's all I know. That's all I know. About
hence
about
the Halo. Low unit cap. No, I think it was Xbox 360.
I don't even know what that means.
Pretty sure it was Xbox 360.
I know that he has that female robot companion, no, like GLaDOS, right?
Oh,
I know he's got
Cortana.
That.
Cortana. It's Cortana. That's the name.
You ruined it.
Trampled all that's over Rhapsody's fine.
That's the one. Damn it. Why?
I had more as well. Oh, well.
What was the joke?
No, you can go fuck yourself. So Halo Wars 2 was Halo Wars the RTS that they tried to do on a console?
Yes. Yes.
Does that work?
Yes, it does actually. The a lot of the it was kind of a weird setup because of the limitations of the console. But a lot of the campaign was you were producing units and you were building bases, but the way that it played is kind of reminiscent of squad-based stuff. It's somewhere in between a traditional RTS and like Dawn of War 2. Somewhere in that middle ground. But when you go into multiplayer, I think you had like 80 maximum unit cap. But most of the units are pretty beefy, and you have multiple units in the same squad. So you can kind of shuffle stuff in and out, and you can get quite a bit of gameplay out of it. But the maps weren't very big because of limitations of the console. Your unit cap is really low because of limitations of the console. And I thought it played pretty dang smoothly for being a console RTS. I got a lot of enjoyment out of it. So I'm hoping, since this is a dedicated release for Xbox One, which is way more powerful, and Windows 10 side by side, that you will have some much better options in this. So, yeah. The Halo universe is an awesome place, and Halo Wars 1 was pretty solid. So I'm tentatively optimistic for this game.
Well, I mean, they have to do some sort of saving grace, right? Because the Xbox One is not really up there in terms of its exclusives at the moment, right? Halo was the big mover, and the Master Chief Collection was abysmal. By all accounts, it was absolutely horrible and broken in all ways on release.
Well, this is another Halo game, so I mean, they're not really branching out too much.
Exactly, they need some sort of saving throw for the Halo series to bring it back to the forefront so that they can continue using it to move their consoles.
I mean, the leaked screenshots look pretty sexy, if they're real. I don't see them not being real because, I don't know, unless it's some kind of super low-key mod for the original Halo Wars, it does look like a definite graphical upfit from the original one. But, yeah, pretty sexy.
Let's see what happens.
Don't even know. Don't even know what Halo is. I don't even know. Don't even know.
Don't talk to me, Potato. Good.
Glad we've established.
Don't
that.
Ever.
Was that your impression of me doing an impression of you?
Yep. We're three levels deep, baby.
That's so deep that the joke's
it's imperception.
Almost not funny. You know, so
See, I only wasn't funny when I originally did it, and then it was less funny when you did it. So if it's almost not funny when I do it for the third time,
it's actually
still a super
better.
Huge increase over yours.
Are you kidding me? I make your jokes great again.
All right, Orbital. All right, Trump. Let's talk about CD Projekt Red, and specifically the Polish government that have launched an $18 million cooperative fund between the two of them to try and get games innovation in the Polish area. This is really good, as far as I'm concerned, that they are specifically trying to push for games innovation in Poland, because they have made some of the most interesting and innovative games over the past decade.
Can you name some?
The Witcher series. I was going to say that, but I didn't want to.
A really good example. I'm looking, because I remember that there were a bunch of games that I was looking at, and I was like, was made by a Polish company.
Yeah, 9 developers in the region: CD Projekt Red, Dying Light, Outlet, Techland, CI Games, 11-Bit Studios.
The Call of Juarez games were made there, Bulletstorm was made there, Dying Light and Dead Island were made there.
Wow.
I did not know that killer. Yeah.
The Vanishing of Ethan Carter is actually a really good example of this, which I thought was absolutely amazing. Mm-hmm. This War of Mine was made by a Polish studio, Lords of the Fallen. I think we know my feelings on that. We talked about it a while ago. It was made by a Polish studio, unfortunately. Sniper, all of the Sniper games. Super Hot, which was one of the most innovative games to come out recently.
That is
super. Hot.
Super. Super. Hot. Super hot.
Wow. Okay, so I can tell you how this would go down if this was in the United States. Basically, you'd have several large companies that threw out the stupidest idea that they could think of that no one had done before, and they would snap up all of this funding. But since you're not the United States, maybe something good will happen with this.
I mean, I'm really interested in seeing it happen, because I don't want the... Basically, what I'm fucking sick of is the big Western hubs of civilization being the creators of the world's largest games that kind of go everywhere, because you only get to see that experience, like the slice of life that comes from London, Montreal, Canada, the Silicon Valley in the United States, and sometimes you see stuff from, I guess, Australia.
Hey, don't forget Dundee in Scotland, where they originally made Grand Theft Auto. That's right, Dundee in Scotland.
Where they originally made the... Yeah, no, I've heard about that. You told me like 5 seconds ago. But honestly, that's really boring. Seeing games from more diverse nations and more diverse backgrounds brings so much beauty and intricacy to it. Like, for example, the best RPGs of the last decade, as far as I'm concerned, have been Dark Souls and The Witcher series. Mm-hmm. And those are both people from Japan and Poland, respectively, doing their versions of a Western RPG. And it's way more interesting than almost every Western RPG, right?
Could that
result in better games?
Could that have something to do with the fact that they're not under the thumb of one of the big publishers in the United States?
Also, yes, also completely possible. And seeing basically the ability for these people to be funding indies, because that is the majority of what they're going to be funding, is really, really exciting.
They're funding good ideas instead of money-making IPs. Is basically what it boils down to.
I'm way more interested in seeing someone trying to get the industry to grow in a natural way and to grow through good ideas, rather than going, here's the bottom line, we need to make this much money, we need to return this much to our shareholders.
Here's the formula.
We're gonna have to do this much advertising, and we're gonna have to have this shitty vertical slice cinematic that we're gonna show at E3, that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
I don't think that that's something that's specific to Poland or to diverse places, because I think you can still get that everywhere. But at the same time, I think that $18 million fund for gaming innovation, that's dope. I think that's good. It's good shit right there.
You totally can get that anywhere. And you can have indie studios all over the world. There's two different points that I'm trying to make here at the same time that I think you might be conflating. One of which being, I'm really interested to see more indie game studios being able to have access to funds to create these innovative game ideas. And secondly, I'm more interested in seeing diverse groups of people and nations that typically haven't had large representation in the media creating more and more games,
yeah.
because it diversifies the yeah. experience of things that you get to see in games. It's really interesting.
Yeah.
This yeah. could potentially get new companies off the ground as well, because a lot of the struggle yeah. with like one or two man companies or these smaller entities that haven't had a breakout hit yet is that you cannot get funding, and creating a game is very time intensive. So it's not something where you can easily have like a side job or a full-time job to eat and yeah. also develop a game, because it takes a mental toll on you to work, and then you're not as sharp and you don't have any time to actually work on what you want to with your project. So we could see a lot of cool things come out of the woodwork with this, where people are like, you know, there's this thing that I've been wanting to do for like 18 months or 2 years or 5 years, and I've never been able to do it before. Let's give this a shot, and maybe they'll make it. Who knows?
I think exactly. we should make a video game. I think we should make a video game.
No.
Just think about how much of a diverse experience it would be. Look, we've got experiences from
Australasia.
Oh, if we could just have another studio that's only white men. Oh, beautiful. Imagine the diverse games.
Are you really going down that road? Really?
Look, think about it. Think about it. Look at the diverse games that we could make. Look, a game that's made on different continents. How crazy would that be?
I can speak from personal experience here. Everything that I just said about working and free time and how sharp you are mentally, I have been down that road where I like basically killed myself for a month, month and a half, 2 months, trying to make multiple things happen, and eventually just gave up because I could never get it to go anywhere. Because if you're expending your energy on getting the income that you need to live, then mm-hmm. you don't have enough to spend elsewhere.
Yeah.
Like, speaking realistically, the time that I spend making things for YouTube, I give up basically all of my free time just to get that done. So yeah. to do something else on top of that is completely unfeasible. So.
So what you're saying is that we can't make a video game. Is that what you're telling
that
me?
That is exactly what I'm saying.
Damn. Darn it.
If you want to go out on a limb and try it for yourself, I will come back to you in 3 months when you're a broken husk of a man and tell you I told you so.
I'm just going to release my game on Early Access and call it Podcast Tycoon. And we're going to make fucking millions, boys. Millions.
What you need to do is make some YouTuber bait as well, right? So it needs to
That's great.
I don't know. Maybe you can have like a simulator of being a Let's Player. Oh.
That's a good idea. That's a good idea.
Okay, so there's a couple of guys.
Let's Player Tycoon.
There's a couple of guys who rip PNGs of PewDiePie and make games out of them. You just need to come up with a different major YouTuber and just like make Flash games for bait on their sites mm-hmm. and sell it for like 99 cents a pop. And when the 2 million fans of fill in the blank YouTuber come and buy your thing, I mean, 2 million times 99 cents is still a lot of money.
That's also almost a 100% hit rate for subscriber to purchase ratio.
Guys, this is great. This is next level. This is how I'm gonna make it big
not.
In the world of YouTube.
No.
This is it. This is
I'm not buying into this. No, not that way. It's not worth it.
Oh, damn, so close. So close.
So speaking of crappy Flash games, what have you guys been playing this week? And I was not playing a crappy Flash game this week. I did not touch Diep or Slither or anything else. So don't look at me.
Well, but what have you been playing?
All right. I've been playing Warhammer, Total War Warhammer. I actually completed the game today, which is insane because I don't complete games all that often, but I completed it. I did the campaign. I'm super, super happy with the way that it turned out. Absolutely still in love with that game. And And yeah, it's pretty good. Now, as you may know, ladies and gents, Rhapsody is a little bit of a busy bee recently. Okay, you know, he's working his socks off, and you know, for that, I commend you, my friend. However, I thought it would be a little bit of a challenge for you to pretend that you've actually played a completely different game that you've not played, okay? And you need to pretend that you know exactly what you're talking about, and you need to tell me all about your experiences with that game and what you've had this week. So,
Orbital, what game have I been playing this week?
You have been playing Grand Theft Auto Vice City. There we go. El Clasico. Dundee Clasico.
I have to give you some bad news. I've played a few hundred hours of that game.
Okay. All right. Fuck. Okay. I thought you wouldn't. I thought
Tommy Vercetti is one of the best main characters.
Shut up. We're not. No. We need. All right. You have played 8-bit armies. Okay. A Brink and Orbital special. You played 8-bit armies. Tell me about your experiences with that.
So honestly, after hearing both Orbital and Brink talk about 8-bit armies last week and just flagrantly disregard the feelings of the developer as they lambasted this game continually, I just want to talk about my experience with the game. So I decided to pick it up and start playing through it. And as far as I'm concerned, it's not that bad of a game. Both of these guys are just talking out their asses, right? So they played like, 30 fucking minutes of it to record a Let's Play. I played 17 hours of it over the past... Actually, I was going to check on Steam. I think it's like 17 and a half. Holy shit, it's 37. That really got away from me. This game is way better than either of these people that have been presenting it. So this is a revolution to the mainstream RTS, because the RTS has been off base for such an incredibly long time. Like, it's been since, I don't know, the original Command & Conquer games. You've actually seen a really, really solid and well-constructed, well-idealized as well, conceptual-based building to force building and then, you know, strategic warfare creation game. And it's beautiful to see that an indie developer has actually managed to bring this into the 21st century. And you might say, Rhapsody, you have no clue what you're talking about, to which I would say, no, I don't. And I've never played the game. I didn't even watch their videos. Man.
I give you fantastic. An A++ and a 10
that
on the landing.
That was great. We should do this more often. We should talk about other people's games all the time. We shouldn't talk about our own. That's boring. Let's talk about other people's games from now on. That was amazing. I love that. Congrats, man. That was hilarious. That was good.
What I've been playing this week. Brink, what have you been playing?
I've actually also been playing Total Warhammer / Hearts of Iron. So, yeah, venturing out into a couple of things that I've never done before, because I've never played a Total War game, and I have never played anything from, is it Paradox? Stellaris, Hearts of Iron, that kind of thing.
Yep,
so
Paradox Interactive, yep.
New experiences all the way around. I'm liking Total Warhammer. I really am. It is a great balance between the economy and politics and all of that kind of stuff and the actual warfare. Hearts of Iron, not gonna lie, might be a little too detail-oriented for me. It just moves so slowly. But, on the other hand, I love history, and I like reading about World War II, and the amount of detail that they put into this game, just the sheer... I can't even come up with a good description of it. Like, even the ability to vary the specs on the individual tanks and ships and things that you're creating. Like, you can control every minutia of every aspect of your country. And it's incredible to me. I'm not really willing to go to that level of detail, but just reading all of the different stuff that's available to you and kind of delving into that is just a unique experience, one that I've not seen before.
So I think you might agree with me on this, is that this game, I think, and I've thought a lot about this, I think that this game actually over-simulates a whole bunch of stuff. There are so many numbers, there are so many modifiers that I think could be cut out and it could be stripped away and made into a much more streamlined game. Because you know, you'll go into a technology page or it does plus 5% for something. It's like, well, when do these conditions apply? We have no idea. And unless you're, you know, going to, you know, stick in hundreds and hundreds of hours into this game.
I was about to say, you'd have to play through it. You'd have to play through it 5 or 6 times just to get a general idea of how you branch out the tech and ideological trees. And then maybe on your 6th or 7th, you could actually pick a goal and be able to go after it and accomplish it without having to read for 3 hours about what all the different options do.
Yeah. So I think that this, I think it, you know, I don't think it suffers from like over, what do you call it? Over simulation, so to speak. But I think that it would be better if it was a little bit more streamlined, but I like
it. Definitely caters to a specific type of player, because if you're a casual player, like me, I don't know if I'm going to continue it or not yet, because I have a very limited amount of time in which to play things. And like Total War is right on the outer edge of that. And with Hearts of Iron, it would take me 25 or 30 hours playing this game just to understand what's going on, which is kind of it's a high entry point, bar of entry, whatever you call it.
I think that this stands out from a bunch of other Paradox games. For example, Europa Universalis 4 is a game which is so unbelievably much more simple than the Hearts of Iron franchise. Same with Stellaris. Stellaris is like, you know, it's like boiling an egg in comparison. It's so simple. I mean, I presume you guys can boil eggs, right? I mean, that's...
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. You know, Rhapsody being a student and all, I wasn't quite sure. It's a completely different league.
Boiling eggs is like cooking ramen, but without the ramen and putting an egg in instead.
Dude, I mean, it's like mean fucking breakfast. Step the fuck off. I'll fight you.
All right.
Can you do a poached egg properly?
Yes.
All right. You're good.
What do you mean properly? Are we talking like runny yolky bits? Is that what you call properly?
And orbital fails.
What'd you call properly? I would call properly anything that is not like runny whites and a nice yolky inside. Like, am I just going insane? Like, what? What is a proper poached egg? Tell me then. All right. Fuck my story of Hearts of Iron. Tell me about poached egg.
I'm not even going there.
Nope. No, tell me. Fucking tell me. You fucking accuse me of, Orbital fails this test because he's a fucking idiot. You know? So what is the criteria for a properly cooked poached egg? You know? Please share.
I mean,
please.
Typically it involves a saucepan and depth of water. And you basically boil it inside of that in such a way to allow the yolk to still be. Yeah, honestly, your description wasn't abysmal, but the way in which it was described was, I guess, the way that made you fail.
Fuck you guys. My God.
You're killing me.
I killed a mentally fantastic poached egg. Oh, Brink shoots me down. Rhapsody shoots me down.
I didn't shoot you down. I just told you that I would fight you. And by fight you, I meant cook you a nice breakfast, at which point you would have to concede that I can cook a nice breakfast.
Hey, that's the best kind of fight.
I mean, to be fair, I can't cook dinner or lunch for shit, but I can cook breakfast 3 times a day, so...
We've just discovered how to resolve all the world's conflicts. Everybody cook a breakfast, and whoever's tastes the best wins.
You need breakfast? You need
It's like Iron Chef on a global scale.
You know who we can get to help out? Master Chief. Master Chef.
Master Chief, you fucked it up in the only time you needed.
Potato, you done fucked it up.
I fucked it up. It's because I was thinking, okay, what's the opposite of Master? Oh, it's Master Chief. So I was just doing the opposite. fucked it up. Oh well.
You know what? Master Chef on the Iron Chief program. That's what I want to see. Yeah.
Wow.
All right, bring the ship into bay.
I was about to say, you know what that was? That was a derailment. Again. That is an epic way to end this GD podcast. You are now up to date on what news is interesting, and thank you so much for tuning in and watching us. Happy to have you guys, Potato and Rhapsody. We'll see you in the next one.
Adios.